Almost Real with Justin and friends. It's Justin and friends, Almost Real.
Hey everyone, I'm Justin on the Almost Real show. Well, we call it Justin and Friends because I got a lot of friends in show business, and this is one of them right here, Eddie Carnevale, also known as the Possum Man. He's a crazy gig you've been doing all these years, Eddie. I tell you what, it's a crazy character that I can relate. You know what I mean? Because I'm kind of the character myself.
Yeah.
How you doing, Eddie?
Well, I'm doing all right. How you doing? You're looking good.
Well, thank you, Eddie.
Where did you get that tan from?
Well, I've been at the beach, you know, hanging out, you know. I ain't using any more of that stuff from the dollar store, because that stuff will turn you orange, you know what I'm talking about? But you know what, Eddie? I ain't kidding you. I was looking at that magazine right there. Hold it up. Show everyone.
Yeah.
It's called The Hitchhiker's Guide, and I was intrigued by the fact that you were on the cover of that magazine many years ago with a guy named Earl Lurks.
Oh, yes, I was. He was well known with Ronnie Dangerfield, one of his all-stars of comedy. And he invited me out to do this pig racing tour that he found out in Seattle. And we went out there. And actually, these people in Seattle had a business in Alaska.
Whoa.
And he bought me plane tickets there, but I didn't believe him because he always told me that he was going to do all this, make all these clubs and stuff like that, and I didn't believe him. So I never packed anything up.
Did you actually go pig racing with him, or is that just a story he told?
No, I did, but I wasn't ready to go pig racing because I didn't think there really pig racing existed.
I thought you were a comedian that then too, weren't you?
Yeah, I was doing comedy at the State Theater with him. And
so you and Earl were at the State Theater doing comedy downtown St. Petersburg, and you were getting quite a crowd, weren't you?
Oh yeah, I got this. But this article here was the pigs, but we were 550 seat venue, and I had 60 of those people coming out just to see the Possum, which I really didn't have any punchlines. At that time, I really was getting into comedy. I wasn't quite sure what I was doing still.
Well, you had the character, though.
But I had the character. I was getting a character at that time. Yeah.
Well, I can relate to that. Being a character is what it's all about in show business. But, you know, that article you got called The Hitchhiker's Guide?
Yeah.
Does it color the story about you being in Alaska with Earl Lurks?
Yes, it does. It talks about, you know, when I went down there and up there and all the way out into Alaska. See, what I didn't know that we were going to do this. I had nothing packed up. So when he came, he was a little upset that I didn't pack anything up and then produced tickets to fly to Alaska with my name on them. You know, you got the job and you're coming to Alaska.
I thought you guys drove a bus out there, though.
We did. A broken down school bus with a horse trough in the back for a bathtub.
Did you get that one from the Partridge family, or where did you get that?
I don't know. I think it looked like it was from the... It did look like it was from the Partridge family. And, he fixed it up and put a used engine in it, and nobody knew. They didn't believe it either, so the mechanic wasn't ready to fix that bus either.
He wasn't ready?
No, the bus wasn't. I wasn't ready. Neither was the bus. We were a week late getting in to do the pig racing stuff.
What did you guys do? Drive all the way to Seattle, Washington, or something like that?
Yeah, in that bus.
On that bus, and you made it on that old bus.
We broke down every state along the way.
Oh, okay. So you had quite a mechanical experience.
And I didn't know how to drive a bus either, but I learned.
Was it stick shift?
It was funny you said it because it was the year that Speed, the movie Speed. You watch that movie Speed?
Oh yeah, I seen that.
Yeah, well, it was the same year that movie Speed came out, and I really fell into that movie. Really felt like I was really part of that movie after.
So did you guys have pigs on that bus, or?
That was just the tour bus for the comedians to travel in while they were racing pigs.
Oh, okay. So when you got up to Seattle, Washington, what happened? What was the reaction of the people right away, or the promoter, or whatever?
The promoter wasn't very happy about the situation.
Well, what was the situation? What happened?
Well, he thought we were going to have a real bus, like a real tour bus, and he now the Partridge family kind.
Oh, okay, so he was a little disappointed.
Yeah, because he paid him to finance the bus back to him, And he told him it was a real good boss, and really it wasn't.
So the guy was a little surprised to see you, the Possum Man, and this Earl Dirks with his Wonder Dog.
Yes.
In an old Partridge Family style bus.
Yeah, I don't think he liked it too much.
He didn't like it. Well, did he go along with it? He had no choice, did he?
No, he didn't. So I had to get it one day, since we were a week late getting to Seattle. I had one day to get a little bit of training about pigs, which I knew nothing about.
That's funny, man. So you had to train pigs, and what size pigs were they? Were they huge kind or little?
So one of them weighed over 70 pounds, and at that time, when I was doing that, I was kind of a skinny guy, and I was very, you know, I didn't really have as much meat on my bones back then, and I was kind of
You were probably 70 pounds back then.
Yeah, and I was trying to lift him up, and he was shaking me like a jackhammer at one of the shows.
And so, did you enjoy doing that pig racing? Was it fun?
Well, not really, because I only had a day's training, and the next day later, I had clothes that they bought me, already packed in a suitcase, and I was down to the airport with half a day's training, and not sure what I was going to do, and flew all the way to Alaska.
Well, did the pig slide with you guys, or what happened?
No, I had to pick them up the next morning.
Oh, okay.
Up on a mountain. We had to drive up. We had a van that we had to pick up from the rent-a-car place and drive all the way up a mountain to go to this lady's house to train the pigs around a little pig thing, a little pig track, and pick them up there.
Wow.
And then we had to drive 700 miles that day.
700 miles.
Wow. 700 miles to our first show after flying all day.
Where was your shows? Where were you guys doing shows?
I think the first show was out in... Sodotna, Alaska.
Is that like an Indian name or something?
I don't know. They have I played up in Fairbanks. We went to Fairbanks,
Sodotna,
and Palmer.
Palmer.
And Haines was the last.
Haines.
Haines City was Haines was the last in Alaska, but then I went to Chicago to do it too.
Well, you guys drove across country with the pigs to Chicago too.
Yes.
Well, I heard a story one night you were, you told me that, that Earl had quite an episode with the pigs.
Oh yeah, he did. I was working for the promoter's brother cooking food, because you know I cook food.
Right.
And I was working at a concession stand at the fair, you know, cooking some food.
Yeah.
And then during the day, I would race the pigs, and then, you know, we would all go out after work was done and go drinking at the bar, which was like sunsets in Alaska about 10:30.
Oh,
at
wow.
Night. Yeah, 11 o'clock. Weird. The sun just went down.
Wow, there are a lot of drinking folks that like that one.
Oh, yeah. So 5 o'clock in the morning, it was pretty dark, but the sun was coming back up. And, Earl said on the way home from drinking, stop the bus, stop the van. I want to get out. And I just wonder why he wanted to get out. And he said he had to go check on the pigs.
Yeah, check on the pigs late at night.
Yeah, he said he's got to go down there and check on them. I said, well, I'm tired. It's been a long, long day, and I worked, and I cooked, and I raised pigs, and I'm not going to check on the pigs. I'm going to go
back and go to sleep.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Sounds like a comedian's road gig. That's what it sounds like.
Yeah, I was like in a trailer, you know, and sleeping in a trailer out there, and it was really cold, and it was inside the kitchen, but I wasn't supposed to tell anybody about that. Yeah. And the next morning later... Earl came back, you know, it was morning time, and he was pounding on the windows, and he looked very nervous. And I asked him what was wrong.
What was wrong?
I guess apparently security came late at night, asked him why he's checking on the pigs.
Why didn't he tell him? He's Earl Dirks. He's the guy in charge
because
of the pigs.
He used to be a Marine, and he feels like these little kids are just little park rangers. They're nothing compared to him. He's the pig man. He does the shows.
He does the show.
Right. And if it wasn't for him, the show doesn't go on. Oh, and that's what he told them. And they came after him with flashlights. They told him to halt. That's what they said.
They told him to halt. And he's a Marine, so he probably went into Rambo mode or something.
He did. He went into Rambo mode. And he hit all night from them. And they had choppers flying around.
Oh, man. Dragon, the story's getting good. We got to take a commercial break, folks. I can't believe it, but we do.
Oh,
we'll
wow.
be back
okay.
right after this message, and we'll hear more about the pig racing. We'll hear right. more about Possum Man's career and show business, all right after this great commercial from one of our sponsors.
This here's Jenny J on the Justin and Friends show, Almost Real. Listen, folks, I got another safety tip. I guess you could call it safety tip number 3. Right here we got a beautiful Dirt Devil Swivel Glide MVT vacuum cleaner. These are good when you want to clean up your dirty house or your dirty trailer. I tell you what you got to do, though. You got to be careful with these things. Because, say, for example, if I took my hand and stuck it right there like that, right there, see? And then I got a friend of mine turn on the vacuum cleaner. My hand might get clean.
Okay, Mitch Hedberg Project MTV Rough Cut, 7/17/2001.
I'm saying it's kidding.
I'm being a pitch show about me being a stand-up comedian on a bus in the body. I couldn't believe it. It's like, that's the simplest pitch ever, you know? Comic has to go on the road because the crowds refuse to tour. You know, I tried to get a crowd to tour, and we all stay in one place, but they won't do it. I'm a hard act to follow too, because when I'm done, I take the microphone with me. Come on. Man. Be honest with you, I sit around a lot. I just want to avoid ever having to play to a bachelor party again. I'll tell you one thing, man. When you see me on stage, you're gonna like me a lot better.
I was supposed to be on the David Letterman show a couple months ago. It was the same night Madonna was on and she went long, so I got bumped. But I got to eat cantaloupe backstage, so it was still cool. And it was already cut up. I didn't have to fuck with a knife. I got paid $900 to eat cantaloupe. That's fucking unprecedented. I rubbed that shit in my dad's face. I said, you've never been paid that much to eat cantaloupe. You always gotta do it for free. I've been on the David Letterman show 7 times, which is amazing, but I'm still not famous for being on that fucking show. That's the depressing part. Like, I could be on a TV show, and I could be the mystery celebrity, and they wouldn't have to hide me. That's my favorite introduction. You may have seen this next comedian on the David Letterman show. I believe more people have seen me at the store. And that would be a better introduction. You may have seen this next comedian at the store. And people would say, hell yes, I have. He likes cereal.
You put yourself in stupid places. Yes, I think you know it's true. Situations where it's easy.
We're waiting for my friends who are going to be on the show to join us. These guys are going to be on my tour with me. I chose them. I handpicked them. I handpicked them. As opposed to machine picking them, I guess. Like a cat in the end, they'll be a triple threat. That's what they said.
I like hanging out a lot, smelling things.
I don't want to sound like I'm all full of ego on this, but I believe I have a hell of a gift. I really like giving it up.
Shake your bum bum, 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 shake your bum bum.
I'm not a Jerry Seinfeld, I'm just a possum. Possums ain't the best joke tellers. But it's possum. I'm lucky to get this far.
I have no actual good reason why I picked them.
Hey,
you, Eddie. Fucking rock it. Make me proud, make me proud.
I'm trying.
How's it going, Eddie? For your first time I went on stage in Boca Raton, Florida, I was scared to go on by myself, so I told Eddie to go on stage with me. Make me proud, bro. Just remember, the better your set, the more t-shirts you'll move.
Let's give it up for the Possum Man!
Possum Man.
I don't do regular stand-up like that, right? Like, I do stand-up, but I don't. But the Possum is very different. It's something I incorporated. It's my own bit. I originated it. I invented it. I'm the Possum. I'll tell you folks something right now. I'm not having much luck meeting any women.
And he just wants to change this. He does the Possum thing right away. He doesn't tell any jokes. He goes into the 5-minute explanation of the Possum. He should bust out some jokes. A lot of words, man, without a punchline.
If you guys want a shirt after the show, I'm selling these Possum shirts, man, so in case anybody wants to buy them, man. So.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I think I need to, I think I know where I, screwed up some things. So I need to put them more on cue, right? They were a little off cue, right?
They were off cue? The audience?
No.
Oh.
No.
Oh, I didn't hear what you said.
My jokes.
Oh. That was good, man.
Yeah, I can't think about nothing right now.
Just, you know, if you understand, I gotta go on.
I bought a 2-bedroom house. But it's up to me how many bedrooms there are, though, isn't it? This bedroom has an oven in it. This bedroom has a lot of people sitting around watching TV. This bedroom is AKA a hallway. This bedroom's over in that guy's house. Dude, you got one of my bedrooms. Stay out. I got a king size bed. I don't know any kings, but if one came over, I guess you'd be comfortable. Oh, you're a king, you say. Well, you won't believe what I have in store for you. It's to your exact specifications. When I was a boy, I laid in my twin-sized bed wondering where my brother was. I had an apartment, you know, before I had a house, and I had a neighbor. Whenever he would knock on my wall, I knew he wanted me to turn my music down. And that made me angry because I liked loud music. So when he knocked on the wall, I'd fuck with his head. I would say, "Go around. I cannot open the wall." I don't know if you have a doorknob on the other side. Over here, there's nothing. It's just black. Only way you're coming in is through osmosis. Magazine subscription available. The postman just drops them off at my dentist's office for me. And I pick them up when I'm ready. I wish I could play Little League now. I kick some fucking ass. Those little shits be backing up finally. Birds can fly, so if you see a bird running, he didn't need to be somewhere right away. I'm in no hurry. I guess I'll run. I got some time on my talents. Thanks a lot, man. I had fun. Thank you.
Boise, Idaho, and I swear to God, this is a true story. I was walking around, and I saw this duck walking around. It was right in front of me. And I wrote a tired joke about this duck walking around downtown, and it worked. And that's some of the best moments, man, is when you write a joke that's actually true.
I was in Boise, Idaho. I was downtown. I saw a duck downtown. I knew the duck was lost, because ducks ain't supposed to be downtown, you know? There's nothing for them down there. It's too urban. So I went to a sandwich shop, a Subway sandwich. I said, let me have a bun. But they wouldn't sell me just a bun. She said I had to have something on it. She told me it's against regulations for Subway to sell just the bun. I guess the two halves ain't supposed to touch. So I said, all right, put some lettuce on, which they did. They said, that would be $1.75. I said, it's for a duck. They said, all right, well, then it's free. See, I did not know that. Ducks eat for free at Subway. Had I known that, I've ordered a much larger sandwich. Let me have the steak fajita sub. But don't bother ringing it up. It's for a duck. There are six ducks out there. And they all want sun chips.
Should sound something like, say boy, what's your name? No, tell me. Okay, I'll call you Buttercup.
But I've decided that if comedy doesn't work out, I'm just gonna go right into pornography. Cause you know, the outfits are cheaper and it brightens people's days and stuff. But I don't wanna do just porn. Because, like, the rest of my family have done that. What I'm going to do is, like, a whole slew of videos where I do porn, but you get to learn how to make a nice craft, too.
Yeah! I'm the possum, and I'm cooking.
I'm the possum, and I'm cooking, baby.
Well, stress us out, Eddie.
No, this is fun. You're incoherent rambling, stressive performers.
Can I give you one piece of advice? You can take it or leave it. I hate advice. I never tell you, but I can tell you one piece of advice.
What?
Go up there until four jokes in a row that are relatively short. Then do your possible thing.
Why do you do this to me now, Mitch?
What do you mean?
You wait. Never mind.
It's a fucking, it's a
no,
advice.
No, it's cool. I love your advice.
Just go do your thing. Okay, that's all we're saying. Okay?
Possible. You guys are so negative.
Oh, no, don't call us negative, Mitch. No, don't throw something at us, and then when we react to it, call us negative. We're fucking professional comics, you know? No one's trying to bum anyone out.
Okay. Mitch is a very good friend of mine because there was, like, a lot of times where other friends wouldn't help me out, and Mitch would always be there for me. Like if I was hungry or something, Mitch would give me $20.
He doesn't want to be looked over, so he acts weird on purpose. He's really just a normal guy.
So at the bar the other night, I'm giving this chick the possum from across the bar. I'm like, ooh, there, baby, come on. And she starts digging it, right? Well, next thing you know, I'm standing in front of this king-size waterbed with this beautiful, bodacious, blonde bombshell just staring me in the eyes. Not. Come on, folks, you know after you whack down a six-pack of Budweiser and chase down a couple shots of Jack Daniels, you ain't going home with no beautiful, bodacious, blonde bombshell. It was more like a 350-pound fat-ass miter worker with missing teeth.
Good, you know.
There you go. You know what? In reality, he kind of hears you. Yeah, he does. Never responds like...
He's not as stupid as you.
If you say, too much upset, he'll never say, okay.
I told you, brother, I'll hook you up, because I want this to be it, man. You're like my fucking brother, and I'm gonna make sure that you're gonna get a good show.
All right.
Hey, Mitch, if I were to die in Florida, would you come see me?
Of course. Of course I would. You know that. But I wouldn't see you, I'd just see your corpse.
We had a roommate in Florida, his name was Eddie. Eddie was slow on the mental draw. I was writing a letter, I had a problem. I said, Ed, how do you abbreviate Arkansas? He said, I don't know, just start spelling it, then quit.
Refrigerator with a hard-boiled egg inside. After a few days, the shell started to crack. Eddie's first comment was, man, this guy is a survivor. Like you're walking down the street with Eddie in a car, pulled up to you, and you guys got out with ski masks and guns and said, get in the car, we're going to kidnap you. Eddie would have said, shotgun. I'd have been in the backseat with the other kidnapper. Fuck, he called it.
Hey everyone, we are back on the Justin Fringe Show, almost real. That's right, we're almost real because I'm almost real, and my buddy here, Ed Carnadel, comedian extraordinaire, who I've known for many years, is almost real too with his character, the Possum Man. Ed, you know what? We talked about Alaska, we talked about, you know, Earl Dirks and his Wonder Dog and the racing pigs. Wasn't there some guy that worked with you that was kind of famous, who also worked with Earl, whose uncle was Henry Winkler?
Oh, yeah, yeah, that was Bill Bernstein.
Okay, and he worked with you racing pigs too, right?
Yes, he did.
So the Fonz had a nephew that raced pigs. That's amazing.
Yeah, and he was telling me he was going to do a movie about the pigs, but...
Well, I hope he does it someday. But now let's go to another part of your life. Hold that magazine up there. We looked at the Hitchhiker's Guide. This one is the Entertainment Magazine. Everyone sees these on newsstands all the time. This came out a couple of years ago when the tragedy hit that the late, great Mitch Hedberg had passed away. But many people didn't know one thing about Mitch Hedberg. Many people didn't know that you two were roommates years ago, and it's in that article right there. Lynn, his wife, even mentions that you guys were so poor, you guys had an apartment in Fort Lauderdale that you lived on ice cubes.
Is that true? Yes, we did. We had our apartment there, and it was the times when we were first starting out in comedy.
Okay.
And we didn't really know a lot, but we knew what we wanted to do.
Where did you guys work when you were starting out in comedy?
We went to Governor's in Fort Lauderdale, and we played Haggerty's. And
in Boca? I've done that. Yeah, Haggerty's. Yeah, that was a good one.
And Uncle Funny's in Miami.
Oh, wow. So you guys got around a little bit.
Yeah, we played the little clubs down there, and we weren't really sure what we were doing either. We were just testing it out.
And so was Mitch, he didn't have a great big long show like he had later then. He had a couple jokes. You had a couple jokes.
Yeah, it's about the size of it. We had a few jokes.
And so what did you guys do during the day when you weren't doing comedy?
I don't know. I'd go to the beach and, you know, play around and, you know, Mitch got really drunk once, should I say. He was wasted, man. I came out of a closet I was playing doing some Cars stuff, you know, Cars,
the rock and roll band, the Cars.
Yeah, the Cars, you know.
Okay.
I was Gary Numan.
You were Gary Numan.
Yeah, and Mitch was like, oh, I cannot believe it. You better stop with that. Yeah.
So you guys would crack each other up.
Yeah.
That's what you're saying.
Yeah, and I was doing a really good impression of Gary Numan, like,
Oh, okay.
And he's like, you better stop that.
He was laughing, but he wasn't laughing, kind of.
Yeah, I think I was freaking him out.
You're freaking out. Now, years later, when Mitch got real famous, he didn't forget you like some guys do when they get famous. He actually sent for you to go on tour with him, didn't he?
Yeah, we started an MTV road tour. Yeah,
wow.
He actually started it. He pitched an idea and they ran with it.
It was called the Mitch Hedberg Project.
Yes.
And I've been lucky enough to see it. It's a great show, but it never made it to the air. What happened?
Well, the Osbournes came along, Ozzy Osbourne.
Oh, everyone knows Ozzy and Sharon and the kids. Yeah, they were great.
And they were doing the programming department, I guess, and they had to decide which one that they wanted to air. And I guess it didn't make it through the chopping block in business, they call that, the chopping block.
Yeah, I don't like hearing those words. I'm not, you know, wood, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Don't like to hear that at all. Yeah. But anyways, I get what you're saying. Got edited out, kind of like I edited out my old partner on this show, because I figured it'd be better that way.
Yeah.
Yeah, I get you. But I got to tell you, I really, you know, the fact that you and Mitch hung out a lot together is great, and I know you did a tour with him. I saw that show. But I would like it if you would tell them the story that you told me once about you and Mitch in Houston, Texas.
Oh, that story.
Yeah, that was crazy. What happened?
Well, Mitch wanted to do a tribute show to all of his friends. So he invited all of us out to Houston to do a big Mitch get-together show.
Okay.
But his friends only.
All right.
And this was the last stop in Houston, Texas.
All right.
And Mitch told me when he called me up, do not sound like my mom. Mitch and my mom. Well, my mom isn't with us anymore either. God bless her. But it's funny because those two are so much alike. Because Mitch says, whatever you do, Possum, you're not going to take that car. You're not taking the car. So I don't care. You want to take the bus? Take the bus. And he's like, get somebody to take you. I can't get you a plane ticket because it was the last minute deal. It was like $2,000. So very expensive. But he's like, I don't care how you get here, but don't take that car. So I didn't take my car because it was not roadworthy, I guess.
Right.
And
so how'd you go?
Well, I had friends of mine I worked with, and they were like, you got a place in Houston, you're supposed to do comedy? And I was like, yeah. And they talked it over to my friends, and they're like, get in the car, we're going.
And they took their car?
Yeah, and they could put me in the back seat, and they raced all the way to Houston.
Awesome, so it was like road trip.
Yep.
That's cool. So you guys got going down to Houston. What happened when you got there?
Well, they got me to the show in time.
Right, cool.
And I got time to take a shower when I got to the room, checked in. And as I was showering, those guys just were so excited to be in Houston, they had to go get some beer. And it was on a Sunday.
Right.
And there was nothing open at that time. They had to go to a special part of Houston to go get the beer.
Okay.
And apparently they went through some really bad section of Houston to go get the beer.
Okay.
And
so now you got these guys with out-of-state plates that says Florida on it, driving around the bad side of town, I guess you could say.
Well, yeah, but I guess it bothered them that they went somewhere that I didn't know about, because apparently they couldn't get it out of their mind, because the next day later they were so overwhelmed by this place.
Okay.
People dancing in the streets and, you know.
Having a good time.
Yeah, and they said they're living in shacks and stuff like that, like shacks. They've never seen anything like it before.
Whoa.
So they really wanted me to see what they seen.
So they took you there.
Well, what they said was, leave the windows rolled up and we're just going to go by fast and you got to look because we can't stop at the stop sign.
Okay.
So apparently, they just rode through this dangerous section of towns where these people were having a good time. And the police, I guess, happened to be in the area and seen three white boys driving around a bad section of town with Florida license plates.
Okay.
And, well, you know what happened from there.
Oh, yeah. You heard a sound like light flashing, the whole thing, right?
Yeah.
I gotcha.
Yeah, and
so what'd they do when they got you guys?
Well, they had a little conversation, but then my friends came back to get me out of the back seat. And I said, why are you guys getting me involved in this? And like, because you're the guest on Mitch's show.
Right.
And this cop listens to Mitch all the time, so get out and show him the Possum.
So you had to get out in the middle of that side of town with the police.
That's right. I had to do the Possum in the bad side of town.
Now that's funny, folks. I don't care who you are. Right there.
And
so,
So can you do a little Possum real quick?
Oh, sure, yeah. He was really overwhelmed by it. And I'll just give you a little sample
little of that. Possum. Now, folks, if you got a 3D camera, this is really good.
Yeah, so I did that, and he called for backup.
They called for backup. No, yeah. I heard you actually cracked up the police officers.
They called for more than backup. They called, like, half of the Houston Police Department to do it again.
And they wanted you to do it
again. And they were all laughing about it. They were laughing a lot, hysterically laughing. They're like, do that thing again. Do it again. Do it for us. And I was like, okay.
Now, folks, don't try this at home. Don't try this at home. I swear, this is a tough thing to do. He's been doing this for 20-some years. He knows what he's doing. All right. Now, really, I got to ask you one last thing, Ed.
Yeah, go right ahead.
Didn't you go on a radio station for Mitch because he wanted to pull a prank on the DJ?
Yeah, during the MTV road tour, I did.
So what'd you do? You went to the radio station and you told them you were Mitch Hedberg, right?
Yeah, I did. I told him I was Mitch because the guy had never seen him, but Mitch woke me up in the morning and told me that he didn't really want to go to the radio interview, so he's like, can you do it for me?
So you actually went and acted like Mitch?
Yeah, he took me down to the radio station. I walked in and I said I was Mitch, and they asked me how I was doing and everything, where I was going next, and I told them, wherever that bus decides to take me, man, that's where I'm going.
Did they ever find out that you weren't Mitch? What happened?
Well, I started messing up all Mitch's jokes, and Mitch walked in.
Oh, wow. That's
the guy crazy. Wasn't too happy about it. He's like, oh, you got me. Why'd you do this, Mitch? Who is this?
So Mitch actually did the first version of Punk'd on television history. That's amazing. He's had a best time.
That wasn't the first time he did Punk'd on that tour.
That's amazing. Well, look, we're out of time, Eddie. I wish we could talk more. Will you come back and be on my show again?
Well, I'd just like to take a moment and tell Mitch, if he's listening above, that I never forget you, buddy, and the Lord is with you all the time, and the Lord is with me, and I love the connection that you got with me and the Lord and everybody, and
wow, that's pretty heavy, man. I'm almost real, so I almost had a tear in my eye. That I just want to say, God bless everyone listening. We hope you had a good time. This has been my interview on Justin and Friends Almost Real Show with my guest Eddie Carnevale, Possum Man, a good friend of the late Mitch Hedberg's, and we love you all. God bless. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Arr, this is Salvador the Pirate here. Yo-ho in a bottle of rum. I think pirate stories are dumb, but I'll tell you one anyways. There was a friend of mine who was swallowed by a whale for a long time. But a swordfish also was swallowed by the whale. So he took the swordfish and he cut a hole in the whale's teeth. And he got out that way. He was a dentist. Now, if you don't believe that, I got more tall tales from the sea later here on Salvador the Pirate. Arr.
She's awesome. Part of your life, brother.
One night it's like a bar grill that does comedy. One night a week. So I don't know what to expect. No guarantees here. People might not show up. It could be rowdy. People could be eating dinner.
Play small little venues like this. I think what I invented
was made for bigger clubs.
I saw a jar of jelly beans. They're having a contest. I said, guess how many jelly beans are in this jar, and you win a prize. Oh, come on, man. Let me just have some. Let's make a compromise. You guess how many I want. If you said a handful, you are right.
This particular club isn't a mall. Come on. It's not an A1 comedy, you know, event, but it's a very hard club to play.
We got t-shirts and CDs. Possum shirts are Mitch CDs. Anybody?
On the weekends and it's busy, so they start a waiting list. You know, they start calling names out. They start calling names as they say, Dufresne, party of two. They were ready for Dufresne, party of two. If no one answers, they'll say the name again. Dufresne, party of two. But then if no one answers, they'll go around for the next name. Bush, party of three. Yeah, but what happened to the Dufresne? No one seems to give a shit. Who can eat at a time like this? People are missing. You fuckers are selfish. The Dufresnes are in someone's trunk right now with duct tape over their mouth, and they're hungry. That's a double whammy. We need help. Bush, search party of three. You can eat once you find the Dufresnes.
Set up a bullshit audition for the Possum Man, and with my friend Doug Canhope, he's gonna play the audition there. It's 1 a.m., so Eddie thinks he has an audition at 1 a.m.
Give me three words to describe your act. Describe your act to me in three words.
My act is a little, strange and twisted, and it's unique. It stands out.
How about 28 words? I'm just telling you what they're going to tell you when you get down to Tinsley Town.
Think of Falco. Rock me, Amadeus. Rock me, Amadeus. And?
I'm Falco?
Huh? I'm not going to blow a lot of sunshine up your ass. You're a sexy young man. I want you to sit right here. Now, come sit right over here. You work out? Unless you're outdoors, Possum. Naked as a jaybird, except for your underpants, because we don't want to go that far.
I am free as a possum right now.
Maybe what's best, would you mind spending the night? I could get you a cab.
I bought a donut and they gave me a receipt for the donut. I don't need a receipt for a donut. I'll just give you the money and then you give me the donut. And the transaction. We don't need to bring ink and paper into this. I just can't imagine a scenario where I would have to prove that I bought a donut.
Going to the morning radio is a bummer, man. When the alarm goes off, it sucks.
I did a radio interview. The DJ's first question was, who are you? I had to think, is this guy really deep? Or did I drive to the wrong station?
You're back with the Comedy Stylings of Mitch Hedberg.
That's right. Mark is with the comedian and his posse today. Hi, Mark.
Yeah, it's Mitch Hedberg and his peeps. Mitch, what exactly do you guys have in store for us?
Well, I thought I'd just do a little bit of material from our acts. How's everyone doing out in Sacramento? We got a good show tonight at the Punchline. This is just a sample of what you'll be seeing. You don't need the mic. Just do it.
Zach is not going to be here tonight, ladies and gentlemen.
Nothing else. I think everybody here is immensely curious, so you're going to pack the house out of curiosity, if nothing else, alone. More of Good Day Sacramento right after this. We'll be right back.
Hey, you've heard that to me. That's not so right now. Yeah, but I mean, you can worry. But anyway, I'm so sorry to interrupt you.
No, that's all right.
Are you going to trash me from the show if this picks up?
I mean, cut you? You're going to either tip the scale this way or this way. You're the person, you know what I mean? Yeah. You're the weirdest one, man. Don't you think?
Yeah.
You're the strangest character in the whole crew.
Yeah.
You're going to either make it huge or break it hard.
Man sells t-shirts after the show in case someone spills a drink on their clothing. I love Eddie. He leaves them wanting less. Don't fucking get all sentimental. He's the whipping post. He's too fucking crazy to know it. He had a toothbrush with his name on it and said Eddie on the panel. I was going to put an F and an R in front of it, but I knew he wouldn't get it. He'd walk around holding his mouth going, "Who the fuck's Freddy? My teeth hurt."
One kiss now. Make sure you take out the trash the next time you can.
Just one kiss.
What if we die tonight?
We're
like Tom Cruise in the coffin.
Thank you very much.
Just wanted to let you know thanks. I mean, if any friend could ever do something good for me, Mitch has done like the best thing in my life. For real. Yeah. Because, only Mitch understands that. No other people know that. I mean, my family don't understand it. Nobody understands it. I mean, and it's so... I mean, it's the happiest thing in my life. So. I'm really, really, really happy. I mean, that means I could be. I just thought I should know. Thank you.
Yeah, I really appreciate that they're having fun, and I'm glad I could do something for them.
I never had a piggy bank, but one time I had some bacon that tasted like change.
My friend won a key to the city, and it did not say do not duplicate on it, so now we all got them.
Hey, if you want to talk to me after the show, I'll be fucking surprised.
We'll be right back.
And we're back with Justin and Friends, Almost Real.
Yeah. Hey, welcome back, folks. I got my guest, Eddie Carnevale, who's also known as the Possum Man to most of his comedy friends in the comedy world. And Eddie, show them that article right there. You were on the cover of the Tampa Bay magazine years ago when they had a story about, Last Comic Standing. And Eddie actually camped out all night to get on to Last Comic Standing. Isn't that right?
Yes, I did.
And didn't you use something from your place of work to that you were a little afraid of? Could you tell that story?
Yeah, my boss let me borrow one of the burners, portable.
Okay.
With a butane, you know.
All right.
And told me, go ahead and take this with you. And so I did, and I fired up the burner in the morning, and I had one of them old coffee pots. You know those old coffee percolator pots?
All right. So now, folks, you got to get this. He's looking like an old dude on the street with a tent, camped out in front of the place they're going to film Last Comic Standing. He's got a little burner going, and he's got his coffee in his hand.
Yeah, and it was cold out, very cold.
Right.
And I camped out, and I start the coffee, waiting in line. And, you know, hot coffee, and I was like, hey, anybody need hot coffee? You know, it's early in the morning, got about a long ways to wait. And the next thing you know, when I woke up in there, I'm making my coffee, all the reporters were around me all snapping pictures. And
oh, wow. And so then you got on the cover of the Tampa Bay magazine or newspaper, right?
Yeah, but you see, the thing that I was worried about was that I didn't want my boss reading the paper because the burner was on the front cover. And I was hoping he wouldn't read the paper.
You were afraid if he saw that, your job's in jeopardy.
Yeah, I'm like, oh, I hope he doesn't. That's why I couldn't tell him. I wanted to tell him about it, but I was like, no, I better not.
In case you folks don't know, Eddie is also a cook. This guy's cooked for some famous people like Leanne Rimes, Phyllis Diller, the late Phyllis Diller. He's also cooked for the Hulk Hogan and his kids. Isn't that true?
Yeah, sure did.
Man, you got a great career. You've been a chef, and you've been and a comedian. It's kind of crazy, man. Crazy combination.
Yeah, it's, they go hand in hand, I think, though.
Yeah.
They kind of have a lot of similarities.
What about this magazine right here? Can you grab this from me? This is, called Make Me Laugh.
Yeah, this one here.
You were in this magazine years ago, too. What was that all about?
This was what I was with, in here with, comedian Earl Burks and Winston Wonder Dog. You can see,
Oh, yeah, let's show a picture of Earl Burke so everyone can, if they remember him. That's Earl right there.
That's
he's a great comedian with the Wonder Dog. And you and Earl are still friends, aren't you? You
guys he moved out to Thailand.
He moved to Thailand?
Yeah.
Wow.
He's living out there in Thailand.
Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah.
So he's a character. He was a character.
Yeah, he was a character. That's why I went pig racing with him. It was great.
He's something else. But you know, you did hang out with a lot of comedians that were known, and some guys made a big. Like, you knew Jim Brewer, too, didn't you?
Yeah, I knew Jim Brewer for a while, yeah.
And Jim wrote you a nice little thing one time, I read it. What was that say? What did that say?
I'm not sure what you were talking about.
You had an 8x10 hanging on your wall at your old house. Do you remember that? And it said to...
Oh, yeah, he said, I'll make it big, I'll see you in the movies.
There you go. I remember that. That was awesome. And Jim Brewer's a great guy, man.
Jim Brewer used to make me laugh. As a matter of fact, when we did the Tampa Bay Comedy Awards show way back in 1991, I was told that Jim Brewer has already won the award, but I wasn't supposed to talk about it. And because...
it's like Earl, a surprise, right?
Yeah, Earl Burks asked me who my favorite comedian was. I guess he was inspired what made me laugh all the time, and I told him... Of course you know who that is, Jim Brewer.
Right.
Jim Brewer won. He just got hired on Saturday Night Live after that.
Wow. That's amazing, man. You know some big-name guys that went really huge.
Yeah.
But tonight we're kind of talking a little bit about your good friend Mitch Hedberg, because right after this show we're going to play a little bit of the clips from the original show that was supposed to be on MTV. Isn't that right?
I guess so, yeah. I have some stuff. Yeah.
That's cool. Well, you know what, folks? I'm not real, but I'm almost real, and when he does a possum, it's almost real.
Yeah.
And that's what our show's all about. So we hope you enjoyed this segment of the show. We hope you tune in and listen to us again sometime when me and Eddie are talking about Possum. And I hope to see you on your own TV show soon.
Yeah, my Possum Politics one?
Yeah, I heard about that. Now, that's kind of more of the serious show that you're changing at now, I hear. What's going to happen?
Well, you know, I'm going to see how it goes. You know, I'll probably take it up a notch, you know, a little bit. Now, I'll try to bring a little bit of me, a little bit more, maybe a little more comedy into it or something.
I think that'd be cool. Yeah. That's the way to go, dude. That's like, you got to do it, man. You got to do that. Throw your comedy in there. That's like me. I had to get, I didn't want to be serious, so I thought, how am I going to do this? If I did this without Pete, I could actually go somewhere. So Pete's going out there trying to be a stand-up comedian now, and so I thought, this is my opportunity.
Well, you got to travel with me a lot in the trunk.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I literally, folks, have lived out of the suitcase. Literally. Hey, you've been a great show. You've been a great audience, actually, listening to us out there. You want to say goodnight to the crowd?
Well, folks, thanks for tuning in, and I'm glad to be a guest on the Justin show here. And God bless every one of you, because from American Hearts Radio, we're out to spread the joy and the love and to make you understand from our hearts to your hearts that God and the Lord is a thing, and we are here to change the world and make it a better place for all of us, and get rid of these evil people that just hate us so much. We're going to win. We're going to win, and we're going to show them we're going to fight evil with love.
That's right. I love it. And keep on laughing, folks, because laughter's good medicine. Good night, and God bless.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Yeah. You know, Ed, they say one picture shows 1,000 words. It's like 1,000 words. And you got a picture there that I know means a lot to you because I've seen it on your website. You want to show everyone that one?
Yeah, sure.
This is you and Mitch together. Where is that taken? In your backyard or where?
This was taken for the MTV Road Tour.
Okay.
In front of one of the hotels we were at, and we just got the tour bus.
Wow. Now, what kind of tour bus was that?
That was awesome. Had everything. It's fully loaded.
Didn't you say it was someone famous's tour
bus?
Yeah,
yeah. Marilyn Manson used to use it all the time.
Marilyn Manson used to use that tour bus. How crazy is that? And then Mitch got to use it with you guys.
Well, we told everybody we tied him up and kicked him off the bus and stole it.
Hey, I got to ask you, who all was on that tour bus? It was you and Mitch and
Chuck Savage. He plays bass for Mitch a lot. Okay. And his wife, Lynn Shawcraft.
Right.
Shawcroft. And
Rico.
Yeah, Rico.
Oh,
wow. You know, the brother Rico. And
right.
Yeah, it was our little, you know, we were going to have like our little show.
And how many cities did you guys go to on that tour bus?
We just traveled California, Sacramento, Santa Rosa, and Santa Monica.
Didn't you go to San Francisco too?
San Francisco.
Well, so it was like the S tour.
Yes.
The S tour.
You know how Mitch is.
Yeah, he likes to do things very in alphabetical order, I guess.
Yeah. And he got Punchlines.
The Punchlines?
Yeah, they sponsored it.
Wow, that's cool, man. That is a cool tour.
Yeah, and I killed in downtown San Francisco. Best show I ever had was downtown San Francisco. Great crowd down there.
That's amazing, man.
Well, the people were, actually, it was kind of weird, but the people were very lucked into my comedy there. I was really surprised. Great crowd. Never forget that one.
I'm not, because you kind of do out of their comedy. Your comedy's kind of strange and weird, and it's San Francisco, man. What can I say?
Yeah.
It's like, they understand you.
I think they did.
They understand you. And there's Mike. Hey, Mike, how you doing? That's the producer of the show. How you doing, Mike?
Love you, Justin.
And there's Batman walking in the studio. I love Batman. He's got a new show on, too. You know, Batman's got a show called Amazing Children of the World.
That's great. As a matter of fact, I'm trying to get a guest on my show that talks about exploited children of Florida. And hopefully I'll be getting her on soon.
That would be cool. That would be cool.
Yeah.
Anything that's good messages about good, positive stuff and fighting the evil of the world is all good here. Tell you what.
Well, I tell you guys, I know that Mitch would be real proud of you, Ed.
And you know what, Mitch? I'm glad that you did the stuff that you did for me, and you want me to continue on, and I'm going to try to and keep the legend of Mitch going and continue letting people know, you know, the dream, I guess, will never die. I'll should keep it going, I guess. Keep it
absolutely, Ed.
You will, man. You do. You loved your man. You were his brother.
And now he's your guardian angel, bro.
And this is a great show. And I'm glad that you all got to see some of the behind the scenes here of us making the show called Justin and Friends Almost Real.
Hey, Justin, give it to us.
Yeah.
All right.
Bye-bye, everybody.
If you like the show, thank you. If not, I'm not real. I don't care.
That's a wrap.